with the Republicans in control of the House and the Senate and the executive branch now, why is it so hard to come up with something that everyone can agree on?
Great question, and I get that question a lot. The fact that you have all the levers, mm-hmm. why can't you do something? Well, it is true that the GOP holds a majority in the House and a majority in the Senate and has the White House. But it is untrue that we control all the levers, because there is this phenomenon in the Senate called the Senate rules. And in the Senate rules, for most everything substantive, it requires 60 votes to move to close debate on an item and take it to an up or down vote. So we pass a lot of things in the House because all it takes is a simple majority. So if you're the governing party, you ought to be able to do what you want to do. But when it gets to the Senate, we have trouble moving it across the finish line, primarily because of those Senate rules. Now, there's some other process issues on budgets and appropriations that complicate matters. But in this case, we have to usually find some support on the other side of the aisle to move anything substantial through Congress. And that's the one thing that I would hope that people would take away from this interview, and that is that while the GOP controls all those levers, there are some rules of the Senate that we have to climb over in order to get there. You know, they went nuclear on some of the federal appointments, mm-hmm. And the appointment of Gorsuch to the Supreme Court. But on budgets and appropriations, we still have that threshold standing in front of us.
So what do you think about the latest budget deal, just in general?
Mixed emotions about it. Glad we took care of our defense. We've been really taking some cuts in the national security apparatus of our country that I think has made us weaker militarily. So I'm pleased that we're able to take care of our military. Not happy with the fact that while it wasn't dollar for dollar, that we had to yield to the other side of the aisle to increase non-defense spending to the tune that we did. So in terms of raising the deficit, I thought that raising the deficit for non-defense discretionary spending was a mistake. But back to what we just talked about, Speaker Ryan, his hands were kind of tied. He had to deal with the other side, particularly to get something through the Senate. And so that meant that he had to give to get, and that's always problematic for us.
Now, in this budget agreement, there is a select committee focusing on budget process reform. So you're going to be on this committee. Tell me what you're planning to do and what your reaction is to being selected to the committee.
Well, I expect to be on the committee. The announcement, the formal announcement, won't come till sometime this week. But as chair of the House Budget Committee, it just makes sense that the chief authorizer on the House side in the majority be on that select committee. Look, our blueprint for budgeting is based on a 40-plus-year-old document, the 1974 Budget Act. And it no longer works for Congress or for the American people in the contemporary political climate, partly because of Senate rules, but there are some other issues as well. So it would be my goal as a member of the Select Committee to look at the budget and appropriations process of our government, a fundamental duty of the Congress, and look at ways we can transform that process to something that works today. There'll be a lot of ideas, from biennial budgeting, little things like changing the date of the fiscal year to more of a calendar year, maybe shrinking appropriations committees, doing things that make budgeting and appropriations more doable. As I say, in this climate, the political climate we operate in is very divided, and if you can't get 60 votes in the Senate, then you end up with a continuing resolution. All you have to do is look at where we have been in the entire time I've been in Congress, now in my eighth year, that we've never completed the regular order appropriations process in the Congress since I've been there. And since most members of the House of Representatives are at least my class or later, this is what I describe as the new normal. And that's just not acceptable in America today. Fundamental to what we do is do a budget on time and handle appropriations so that we can keep having the keep from having the government on the cliff in six-week increments. And we have just haven't been able to do that. So process reform is part of that. And then I think sometime during this process, we'll have to get some buy-in from our friends in the Senate as it concerns some of those Senate rules.
Well, let's talk about the political climate. This committee is going to be, it's called the Super Committee, right?
Well, it's a select committee, yes.
Select committee. So it will be half and half. Half Republicans mm-hmm. and half Democrats. Are you going to come to any conclusion? Because don't you think the Democrats might say, well, it's going to, help the Republicans?
You know, great question in today's climate. Because we had a super committee back in 2011 that led to the Budget Control Act, and it was Republican and Democrat split mm-hmm. evenly, and they got nothing done. They couldn't come to agreement. It was completely partisan the entire time. I would hope that we will check partisan affiliations at the door when we meet and look as a committee for what we can do to reach agreement that makes budgeting and the appropriations of the discretionary part of our budget something that we never have to worry about. It will matter a lot as to who the minority leaders in the Senate, Ms. Pelosi and Mr. Schumer, tap to be on this committee from their side of the aisle. I know the group that's going to join me from the Republican side of the aisle in the House, not at liberty to be able to disclose those names, but I will tell you they are people that I believe will sit at the table and have a rational and reasonable conversation with the other side. So realizing that hope is never a method to get something done, I'm very hopeful that this committee, recognizing the difficulty we put our Congress in and, as a result, America in, that we will be able to fundamentally change the way we budget and appropriate.
If you come up with an agreement, what happens next? What's the process?
Well, we have to report out by law on the 30th of November. So whatever this committee will do, and there will be a lot of hearings, there will be a lot of testimony, there will be a lot of ideas that will float up to the surface. Whatever we come up with that we believe we can put in legislative text and be able to pass in both chambers, I'm reasonably optimistic that we'll be able to champion something. It may not be 100% of what every one of us think we ought to do, but I'm absolutely confident that we will get something done that will fundamentally change the way we budget and appropriate. But we have to report out by the 30th, and then it will be up to the chambers, their respective chambers, and the members of the committee to sell it to their colleagues.
What do you think about the food stamps food delivery service idea?
We have to, first of all, I believe in certain types of programs that benefit the needy, but we have, I often say, we've overpromised our country to its people, and some of our policies have created a circumstance where it's more advantageous for somebody to be receiving a government benefit than it is for them to be out earnestly looking for employment. And so from a standpoint of SNAP, and I'm getting to your question, I think that we should be doing anything we can, first of all, to make sure that the benefits that they are getting are of a healthy nature and create the policies that go hand in hand with the producers of the food that we consume in this country. So if there is a commodity-based program that we can institute as opposed to just a plastic card with an amount on it that they can swipe and buy from an entire spectrum of things, then perhaps that would be a better move. Ultimately, what we need is we need people that are able-bodied, people that don't have dependents that are drawing these government benefits to re-enter that workforce, and then we need to take steps necessary to ensure that they have the proper education and or training and certifications and credentialing to be able to go after some of the jobs that we now have available in our society. I have them in the 3rd District. I have a lot of job creators tell me that they're looking for people. They need people. So from a policy perspective, we've got to make some changes in how we deliver not just food aid, but also housing benefits and this sort of thing.
Immigration, what's your answer to immigration reform? This is just a basic question, but like your solution.
Well, look, I supported the president in his call for a proposal that would center around four basic tenets, four pillars, as they call it. Obviously, protection for DACA was one of the primary drivers of the debate. And then border security from our side. We have a heart for the dreamers in this country. But we also want border security, so we're not having to revisit this issue every year or every 5 years. And then there was the subject of diversity lotteries that I think there is growing support to do away with. And then the chain migration issue has also been part of that fundamental discussion. Obviously, last week the Senate took it up. They had three bites at that apple with three different proposals, and they couldn't get anything across the finish line, so that debate goes. And we still have a looming deadline of the 5th of March to be able to come up with a solution or maybe temporarily expand or extend that DACA protection. The president certainly would have that call. But I am very hopeful that we can rally behind a proposal that on one hand can give some relief. What that relief will look like is still to be determined. And at the same time provide the kind of security that I think is necessary for America not to have to be revisiting this issue year over year.
Okay. A healthcare question is the opioid epidemic. We've been covering a lot. We call it the state of addiction. We air stories in the epidemic.
To your credit.
Air stories about people affected. Are you hearing any response to media coverage and...
Yeah. Look, 4029 has done a remarkable job in exposing the crisis that our country is in, and we have, of course, a problem here. There's not a place in America that is not affected by the opioid crisis. And in our last budget agreement, of course, we have taken steps from a resource perspective to be able to go after the opioid crisis. There's no question what it knows no boundaries, socioeconomic or otherwise. It is a problem that continues to be, I call it a productivity problem too, because so much of what is going on in the world of drug abuse and the use of illicit drugs actually goes right to the heart of whether America can fundamentally be a productive country. Too many people suffering from these addictions. There's no way that you can continue to incarcerate your way out of this problem. Incarcerating people with these addictions is certainly not the answer. We have to destigmatize it. We have to treat it as a condition, a medical condition, because it is a medical condition. Look, a lot of the people that have these addictions don't want those addictions. It's just that's why they call it an addiction. They just can't shake it. And as a result of that, it's a vicious cycle that just never ends. And it leads to further problems. It leads to violence. It leads to property crimes and a whole lot of other things. So I wish I had an answer for something like that. There's no magic bullet. There's no real magic solution for what we deal with. It's just that we have to do a better job of treating. And on the other end of the spectrum, our scientific and medical community has done a marvelous job in going after some of the more egregious diseases that affect our society. And so through the National Institutes of Health or through the Centers for Disease Control, we fund those agencies in such a way that at the end of the day, I'm hopeful that we can come up with some kind of solution through the scientific and medical community that would give us relief and being able to help us curtail the use and abuse and eventually eradicate this problem from us. So I'm moved by the many stories that we have. 115 people a day are dying as a result of these overdoses. The drug epidemic that we face today pales, what we faced yesterday pales into comparison to today. These these drugs and these issues that are manifesting themselves on our streets today are absolutely beyond what we experienced back when I was growing up. So, tough issue for our country. I don't know what the long-range solution will be, but we'll find it. I'm confident.
Do you think there needs to be more regulation for these pharmaceutical companies?
Oh, absolutely. We've already got regulations in place determining how people can go and be prescribed these opioids. There's a record-keeping system that is afoot. It is a step in the right direction, but there's many more things we can be doing.
What about infrastructure? How is Arkansas benefiting? What does Arkansas need more from?
Well, first of all, the president has announced what his infrastructure program will be. $1.5 trillion of infrastructure, $200 billion coming from the federal government, the empowerment of public-private partnerships, and the buy-in from a lot of state and local entities. So, you know, to be able to leverage a couple of $100 billion of federal dollars and partner those with what comes out of the private and the local political subdivisions, I think is a wonderful step forward. It will give areas like Northwest Arkansas, where the people here have been willing to tax themselves for better infrastructure. It gives us an opportunity to compete more for those federal dollars, when before the bias was really taking care of population groups of a million or more. No question that infrastructure is important to our area. You can just drive I-49 and you can understand. I mean, we still haven't got the complete bypass done on the north end, and then down on the south end in the valley in Fort Smith, we need to build a bridge. We've got to complete another 12 miles, and that's just to get I-49 all the way around the city of Fort Smith, and then down on through the mountains is a totally different story. But it's going to take a combination of public and private dollars to be able to move the infrastructure that we need moved through. But I am encouraged by what I hear from the president and his proposal.
Okay. What about race relations? Specifically in Arkansas, I can think of a video that was circulating, a woman from Centerton. She made some racist comments to a customer, and that went viral, and Walmart kind of kicked her out from, you know, the stores, or the Black Lives Matter movement, whatnot. Do you think Congress has a role in race relations? If so, what is it?
Well, it's a difficult question. You know, it's what's in a person's heart, and we have to there's no place in our society for the kind of tension that I've seen bubble up in the last several years. We can't practice through our rhetoric or our policies or in our actions. We can't practice any kind of division in our society. And I think these racial tensions manifest themselves I don't know how to put it, but let's just use as an example the kneeling that's going on when the American colors are being honored. No place for that. But we're taking problems in one segment of society and we're trying to address them by using a different platform to be able to bring attention to them, and then I think that further divides the country. What we need is we need people to have a very tolerant heart and understand that not everybody believes as we believe, and recognize that everybody has a place at the table in our society, and we should do everything we can to empower people for the productive good that they can do for our country. And anything that we do that takes away from someone's race or someone's religion, someone's socioeconomic status is unhealthy for our country. And I would hope that people would recognize that if America's going to be strong, then we have to be united and we have to accept everybody for who they are.
Okay. Shooting. Let's talk about the Florida school shooting. And there's so many calls again, once again, to make changes to legislation, gun legislation. Are you getting a lot of phone calls about this?
Well, I get a lot of conversation about it. And people, in the aftermath of a shooting like Parkland or any other shooting for that matter, there is always a knee-jerk reaction that the Congress needs to pass more laws. I'm encouraged by the fact that the President this week has signaled an opportunity to have a little bit more of a discussion about the mental health aspect of it and background checks. Parkland specifically, there were way too many warning signs. It was chilling to see some of the pictures that had been taken, the social media postings, and the threats, either direct or prospective threats of what this individual might do, just a little bit too much for our law enforcement community not to have engaged more heavily in finding out what the true intentions of this particular person was. Obviously, related to Parkland, you had a school issue, you know, yet expulsion of a student, not welcome back on campus because of potential threats. And where local law enforcement fit in that chain of information and eventually how it connected to the federal government is disconcerting to me. Totally preventable, I believe. So how we improve our see something, say something mentality, how we connect the dots from local schools to local law enforcement to federal law enforcement, is something that has to be carefully analyzed as it related to Parkland. Not confident that we're going to be able to eradicate all of the potential harm that could come and the threats against humanity out there, because there's a lot of mental illness. We've talked about drug abuse. There's a lot of external factors that are creating some of these, and you still have the radicalization of some of the rogue groups around the country that are causing people to self-radicalize. So I'm not sure you're ever going to be able to get your arms completely around it, but there were certain things about the Parkland shooting that we should have been able to engage before this happened.
I'm going to break this question down into a couple, because there's so many things that we can talk about. First, you brought up the mental health. Well, how do we make sure that people with mental illnesses that their needs are met, and at the same time, that the community is safe?
Well, that's a tough societal issue that we face today, because you have certain constitutional protections, HIPAA laws and this sort of thing. And at the same time, we have a need to protect ourselves. So trying to find that delicate balance is a conversation that's going to happen in Washington, D.C. at the federal level. And I believe it's going to have to happen in communities across our country. How we resolve it and how we are able to both protect patient privacy and at the same time protect the general public is always going to be a very difficult trying to find that is going to be a difficult sweet spot to find.
Do you think more money needs to go into the mental health fix?
Short answer is yes. The longer answer is you just can't throw money at a lot of these issues, because money by itself is not going to fix anything. But I think one of the key things we can do is destigmatize the mental illness condition. Mental illness is here. Mental illness has always been here. We still have to find a way to get the proper treatment for, and if it takes medication, the proper medications for people that suffer from mental illness. But I think it's a classic case of where it's look the other way on the issue. Unless you have somebody, know somebody that is suffering from a mental illness, then it's always someone else's problem. We have to recognize that it may not affect us, but it does affect us, because anytime you have an issue like a mental health or a substance abuse issue, even though it may not directly impact us, indirectly it always impacts us because of the drain on resources. I don't think you can just solve it by throwing money at it. I think it's going to take a community effort And it's going to take law enforcement to be at the table. It's going to take our churches to be at the table. It's going to take our taxpayers to be at the table in a variety of forms. So we've got to have a holistic approach to it, but destigmatizing, I think, is part of that key.
What are you hearing from local law enforcement on an event like this? What do they need from you?
Well, I think what local law enforcement wants is they want our society to be able to deal with the people that could be repeat offenders in their jobs, and then our local law enforcement personnel want to be resourced and equipped to be able to handle it. There's a big difference between just a normal law enforcement interaction with a citizen and a law enforcement interaction with somebody suffering from a mental health case. And it's far too prevalent today. There's a lot of pressures on people. There's a lot of lot of drug abuse. And so the chemical imbalances that are happening as a result of introducing yourself to, introducing your body to illicit drugs is creating a real problem for them. So I think they just want to be properly trained, properly manned, properly equipped to be able to deal with the issues that we see today. And then I think in terms of guns, I think law enforcement would like to see the Congress of the United States take a look at some of the access issues that we have for people that may be suffering from mental health and their ability to own firearms, because it's the possession of that firearm that creates, I think, the biggest threat to society as we know it. So, but it's a conversation's been going on for a long time, and trying to figure out how do you protect the constitutional rights of everyday citizens and at the same time deal with that segment of the population has always been a bit elusive.
Do you think the Second Amendment needs to be looked at
a
little closer?
No, absolutely not. The Second Amendment is there for a purpose, and I'm not a big fan of the federal government dictating to law-abiding citizens what they should have or not have. So I don't think we have a Second Amendment issue necessarily. I think what we have is a very serious mental health issue that relates to the Second Amendment that we need to be addressing. And that's the solution that I think we continue to pursue.
What about schools, local schools? What do they need from the federal government?
Well, I'm not for the federal government telling the local schools how they should act, what they should be doing. But look, our schools have the capacity to limit access onto the school grounds in terms of how somebody could breach a security point, this sort of thing. We've already got armed guards. Parkland had an armed security officer. Wasn't useful in this particular case, I suppose, because of where the guy entered. But I think this is an issue that local schools ought to take up and make sure that the personnel that operate our schools have their heads on a swivel. I'm a big fan of watchdog dads and this sort of thing. I think that under certain circumstances, it should be possible for armed personnel, whether it's a police officer or somebody with absolute training or former military, to be in a position to have a job in a school like that, to where they could serve as a security outpost for the local kids. So, but again, I think it's I would not want the federal government prescribing what those conditions are. I think that would be best left to the local jurisdiction.